Christ. Today we'll be reading from Matthew chapter 16, verse 21 to 28, 20 to 27, I mean. So Matthew chapter 16, we'll start with verse 21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders, chief priests, scribes, and be killed, and on the third day he raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done." May the Lord bless his word. Today, the cross is revered and respected. People even wear necklaces. Shiny crosses are hanging around their necks. People have bumper stickers with colorful crosses on them, and they have sentimental pictures of the cross hanging on their wall. But it was not so in Jesus' time. The true reality of the cross was extremely harsh, barbaric, and revolting. Understanding the harsh realities of crucifixion in antiquity, I think, helps us to understand the truth about the cross of Christ. This will help us to overcome the acute loss of reality in our present thinking about the cross. And I believe it will aid us in living as true Christians in this present evil age. Now, crucifixion was the supreme penalty in the Roman legal system. It was called the summum sepulchrum. The three most severe punishments were decapitation, cremation, and the cross. And the cross was the most severe. In most Roman writers, crucifixion appears as the typical punishment for slaves. It was almost always inflicted on the lower class, the slaves and foreigners. It was above all else a deterrent against slave rebellion. Rarely were Roman citizens crucified. The upper class could reckon with more humane punishments. Crucifixion was a most barbaric form of execution of the utmost cruelty. It was normally combined with all sorts of cruelties like impaling the private parts, burning, flogging. And during crucifixion, the caprice and sadism of the executioners were given full rein. The crucifixion lengthened considerably the dying process. And the cross elicited strong emotions in the ancient world. It was considered an utterly offensive and obscene affair. The ancient writer Cicero, for example, calls the cross the plague. Josephus called it the most wretched of deaths. It was deemed so cruel and barbaric that ancient writers were reluctant to write about it. The cultured literary world deemed it necessary, but wanted little to do with it. There's a scarcity of references to it in literature, but it was used as a vulgar, abusive taunt among the lower classes. It was found on the lips of slaves and prostitutes. The fact that Jesus Christ died on the cross made Christianity offensive to the Roman world. The Roman governor Pliny, for example, considered Christianity to be perverse and extravagant superstition. It was offensive that the one who was so honored as God would be nailed to the cross by the Roman authorities as a state criminal. Octavius called Christianity a sick delusion, a senseless, crazy superstition that they worshiped one who was crucified. There was a well-known illustration from ancient Rome that shows the contempt the Roman world placed on Christianity. It was an illustration of a human figure on a cross with a donkey's head. Connected to this was the inscription, Alexinus worships God. No wonder Paul wrote that in the eyes of those who are perishing, the word of the cross is folly. The word folly in the Greek means crazy or madness. The message of the cross was simply scandalous. In fact, the prophet, hundreds of years beforehand, said that he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, as one from whom men hid their faces. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Jesus died like a slave or a common criminal in torment on a tree of shame. He did not die any death. He was given up for all on the cross in a cruel and contemptible way. Understanding the barbarity and scandalous nature of the cross helps us to better understand the truth about Christ's cross. It helps us to comprehend more accurately the depth of his self-sacrifice. He knew full well that he would be crucified there on the cross. He explained this to his disciples ahead of time, and yet he willingly chose to surrender himself to the supreme shame, humiliation, and most severe pain that the Roman Empire had to offer. He embraced all the severity of it all. But even here, we have not begun to plumb the depths of his self-denial, because his self-sacrifice goes infinitely beyond even what we've now mentioned, the humiliation, the shame suffered on this Roman cross. Not only did he bear ignominy, shame, and humiliation at the hands of the Romans and the Jewish elite, but he also ventured to bear the unsurpassed ignominy, shame, and humiliation of our slavery to sin. You see, he suffered our sin's guilt, shame, and humiliation. He experienced the punishment of eternal separation from the Father. His life was sucked dry of all the hope, joy, and peace that he had for us. He was filled with a terrible, crushing woe of sin's fear, terror, and angst for us. He was left to feel forsaken, heartbroken, as he subjected himself to the penalty of our sins. The true cross of Christ was an absolutely horrible experience. The cross of Christ was the ultimate act of self-denial imaginable. This is just so incredible to me. I believe we need a right appreciation of Christ's humiliation and self-denial on the cross in order to be true followers of Christ. We learn in Matthew 16, the text for today, that after Jesus instructed his disciples on his own death and resurrection, he immediately told them that they too must bear their cross in order to be his disciples and go on to experience the resurrection. Jesus makes it very plain in this text that cross-bearing is not just a small part of the Christian life. No, it is the Christian life. Christ used the cross as one single and complete symbol for the Christian life. Cross-bearing is what distinguishes the Christian from the non-Christian. It is the defining characteristic, feature, or mark of a Christian in this world. Jesus is essentially saying that taking our cross summarizes the entire Christian life. The cross is what makes us followers of Christ. The cross is what makes us like our Savior. And the cross is the path to the resurrection and eternal life purchased by Christ on his cross. He says, whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So we must follow the same path as our Savior went. Paul describes his path we must take. He says, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him. Now, the similarity between the cross Jesus bore and the cross we must bear rests on this one point. We cannot atone for our own sins. This Christ has done for us on his cross, but we must yield the self to God, and surrendering all to the will of God. Christ yielded and surrendered himself to the will of God every day, and especially at the cross. And we must do the same. Yielding myself means my whole being, I must give this person, this me, to God by turning to Him, to depend on Him totally. I must give this me to Him by yielding myself to His will in all things. This is what carrying our cross means. God is asking the same thing from us that He asked of Jesus. He is asking us to be His servants. A servant is not above his master, because he trusts his master in all things and obeys his master in all things. A servant is one who relinquishes his dependence and control of himself. He turns to his master for his very need and trusts in his master for guidance in every situation. He is not an expert. His master is the expert. He is not the provider. His master is the provider. The servant depends wholeheartedly on his master. This is what it means to accept Jesus as our Savior. We must trust Him to forgive us our sins. We must trust Him to guide us in His way. We trust His help to do His will. We trust Him for peace and strength. We trust Him with our life. We turn to Him for everything because we can do absolutely nothing in ourselves. Now, in order to take up my cross, I must deny myself. It is not natural for me to yield myself to God. It is not natural to relinquish control and give my will to Jesus. Myself, that is me, wants to remain in control. Sin has made it so. So there's a battle to give myself into God's care and control. This is what Jesus meant by saying that we must deny ourselves. I must deny myself the control that I want to have. And this warfare against self, against control, giving up control, is the greatest battle that we will ever fight. The yielding of self, the surrendering all to the will of God, requires a struggle. But the soul must submit. I must yield myself and take up my cross and follow Him. Only then can God save me and help me live out His life in me. I must lay myself, my will, into His care. Now, the experience of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane and on the cross perfectly illustrates the struggle that we have with self, but to an infinitely greater degree. Jesus struggled to put Himself into God's care in the garden. He struggled to trust God to help Him through His terrible spiritual agony as He wrestled with human guilt, shame, and fear caused by sin. His nature wanted to escape the suffering that He was called to bear on behalf of humanity. 3 times He prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as You will." But He won the victory over self by choosing faith. He denied His self's desire to escape by putting His trust in God through the whole ordeal. It was His faith which allowed Him to endure the terrible shame and mockery that He endured without lashing out at His enemies, without giving up His faith in His Father. It was His faith that allowed Him to be obedient even unto the death of the cross. He denied Himself, took up His cross, and followed His Father. Now, Jesus denied Himself and bore the cross even until the bitter end. He accepted the full will of God no matter how repugnant and difficult it was, no matter how much it cut against His own comfort and well-being. Even though the suffering was enormous, He continued on God's path. His mind's eye was stayed on God the whole time. The last words He cried out were these words, "Father, into Your hands I commit my spirit." He rested in His Father's care, even though He had no evidence of this care on the cross. And as a result of His trust in the Father and His self-denial, He rose again on the third day. And this is a direct promise to us. If we trust ourselves to Him moment by moment, hour by hour, day by day, looking to Jesus, we die yet, and we will live again. Now, this experience of taking up our cross is illustrated throughout the scriptures, including in the story of the rich young ruler who refused to give his wealth up to follow Jesus. He desired to follow Jesus. He saw so much good in Jesus, and he came seeking. He was sincere, but he could not yield himself. Now I just want to share with you a brief experience in my own life, just recently, of how God has called me to take up my cross, just to make this very present and very real. I guess being a pastor is not easy. Well, it's not easy to being a Christian. We have a lot of challenges in life. And some of these challenges make us feel totally helpless. The last few weeks, I've dealt with a number of very difficult cases. And I have to say that these cases have just revealed how incompetent I am, have revealed how weak I am, how unable I am to solve these problems. And that has driven me to God, you know, seeking his help. And during the course of that going to God and, you know, relying upon him, God has somehow exposed an area of my life where I was not totally surrendered. An area of my life that was independent of God. And it wasn't so easy recognizing it and giving it up. You see, when I was in college, I didn't have internet. And I didn't really know what it was about. I was too busy studying. When I went to the university, I started using internet just to communicate a little bit, but very little. But when I went to Norway as a pastor, I used it to keep in touch with what was going on here. For me, the internet has always been about news, always been about kind of keeping track of the signs of the times, keeping track of where we are in history. And so it's kind of a pastime that I have. You know, I enjoy studying not just the events that are happening right now, but also knowing about the trends taking place in our society. And so it has been my window to the world. You know, it's what keeps me informed. It's what keeps me knowledgeable about what's going on. Well, God actually showed to me that I was using too much time. It was taking time away from God. It was taking time away from my devotion to God. And he was asking me to give it up. Now, at first, I thought, well, half an hour, you know, if I have at least half an hour. Well, I came to realize that actually that half hour was a chain around my ankle. It was still binding me to that world, which was actually making Christ less powerful, less all-consuming in my life. So I said, okay, well, about 10 minutes. So I started actually using it just for 10 minutes a day. But that chain was still around my ankle. And I felt still that little 10 minutes was somehow binding me to my former interest. Now, at the same time, my wife, of course, she's in Europe, waiting for her visa, struggling with God, asking God to help her. Amen. She was also convicted of God to give up the internet. And it was an incredibly hard sacrifice for her to make because she uses Facebook to keep in touch with her friends and keep in touch with the world. So as a family, we have decided when they come here, we are actually cutting the internet out of our home, period. Now, we do have to use the internet at times for paying bills and for practical things, research or buying books or whatever, and I do have my phone for that, but it'll be used for those kind of practical things. And then, of course, I have the internet in my office for work-related things. But God is calling us to radical faith. He's calling us to cut out those things that are hindering us from walking on water. You know, Ellen White says that to prevent disease from spreading to the body and destroying life, a man would submit to part even with his right hand. Much more should we be willing to surrender that which imperils the life of the soul. In order for us to reach this high ideal, which is Christ's ideal, that which causes soul to stumble must be sacrificed. It is through the will that sin retains its hold upon us. The surrender of the will is represented as plucking out the eye or cutting off the hand. Often it seems to us that to surrender the will to God is to consent to go through life maimed or crippled. But it is better, says the Christ, for life to be maimed, wounded, crippled, if thus you may enter life. Now, I don't know what the Lord is calling you to today. But God is calling us to full devotion to him. And when I mean full devotion, I don't just mean an intellectual faith, but I mean a prayer life, a life of walking in faith and love toward God. And my desire is to walk this path, to be used by Him, to lay aside self in service of my Lord and Savior. And how can I be motivated to do this? Well, I have to be looking to Jesus and to His cross. I have to be dwelling upon the victories that He won. If I am to maintain that devotion to following Him, whatever it costs. May God be with you in your struggle. May He bless you as we partake in these elements and meditate over the cross of Christ. Amen.